belief is that when the phenomena moves with the person, it's associated with the person, we call that poltergeist activity.
It seemed to be a floating kind of light that was interpreted as being an apparition.
Back and forth up there.
It is walking down.
Quiet, everyone. Shh, quiet.
Show yourself, you bastard. Show yourself. You come to hit and hurt me and hurt my children, and now you're not afraid like... And at that point, the first manifestation occurred, which was lights started sort of shooting across the room. And it was the most amazing. And cameras started rolling, and it looked like Roman candles.
Roiling, coiling, misty light started wafting across it, and this thing roiling and so on. And it was stunning in that I knew that something unusual, strange had occurred, never expecting anything like it.
Brilliant lime green, and this corner, this rolling like a plasma, began to take shape. And there was a large upper torso of a man.
I turned to Frank and I said to him, what in the hell was that? And he said, as I recall, I don't know. I don't know.
The Whaley House is, I believe, the most haunted house in the West. I'd be willing to say it's not just the most haunted house in California, it's probably the most haunted house west of the Mississippi.
Some of the letters that we have of Thomas Whaley, after he built the house, they started hearing stomping upstairs, so it had been haunted for quite a long time.
From a very early period here in this house, people were aware that there were unusual things going on.
And all of a sudden, the music box in the formal living room started playing on its own. Well, it startled me really bad, and I jumped up. I went in there, and it really floored me when I found out that the music box was in the off position, and it was still playing.
Thomas Whaley has been seen since 1960 at the top of the stairs by different people, and he has been heard by different people. His baritone laughter was heard in the mid-60s. Around Christmas time, but a few people have seen him in the upstairs landing.
There were hands that people felt touching them. People saw apparitions. Photographs were taken of what appears to be ghosts there.
So in the middle of the night one evening, she went into her parents' room and got a gun, her father's gun, and went out back to the outhouse and shot herself in the stomach.
One of the most intriguing and fascinating pieces of video footage I've ever seen came to me from a man by the name of Daniel Hobbitt. Daniel was investigating a haunted hospital in the San Fernando Valley, and he locked his video camera down in one of the rooms where phenomena was occurring. Let it run for several hours, came back, and then viewed the tape. To his astonishment, there was an image, an astounding image, an incredible image of lights evolving or morphing into an apparition of a clearly defined man.
I think what this footage represents is the possibility that this man has actually captured a poltergeist-related phenomenon on tape. I don't think he meant to do that. I don't think he knew what he was going to find when he put that camera inside the closet. I don't think he expected to find this.
It's either the most elaborate hoax ever attempted, or someone has captured an apparition in videotape. It's one or the other. I mean, there is no middle ground.
What it did to me was reinforce my belief that there's truly something out there, something more than meets the eye.
Back in the 1970s, they began to have the stories coalesce around one room, room 17. And the ghost, we believe, is that of Sylvia, who was found dead, hanging in the closet of room 17. They do see a young girl. They hear her giggling laughter. They hear her footsteps. She's known to be quite a prankster. She's even been known to pinch men on the bottom. My wife acted as medium. We communicated with a spirit, which may have been Sylvia. And from her, we got this bizarre story. According to the material gained in the seance, she had been strangled by a sailor, who, of course, to cover up his murderous act, rigged her up in the closet to look like a suicide, so they wouldn't be after him. And it's because of that that Sylvia is still here.
But I got the lights that have been zooming around. There's been light beams on the, dancing around on the ceiling. And then there was also a shape form.
And she is frightened out of her mind.
Ah! I'm not staying here, Barry. I'm out of here. I gotta get out of here. I can't stay here.
The objects were being thrown across the room. The kids' toys were being levitated off the ground.
Jeff Wheatcraft was physically attacked in this attic on September 4th, 1989 by an invisible force that actually pulled him up onto a nail protruding from a rafter beam and actually tried to strangle him to death.
Why are you focusing your energy on me? Why me? And it spelled out, because you are the likeness of my killer.
When I saw Jeff go flying back against that wall, I thought that it was going to attack one of us next. So I screamed, and I went running out as fast as I could.
It felt like something was coming up right here at this point and striking me, lifting me up out of the chair.
Never in our wildest imaginations would we think that this phenomenon could be so specific in its behavior, in its actions, that it could result in the hanging of a human being, in the physical levitation and tossing of a 200-pound body against a wall like a rag doll.
I saw something that will remain with me the rest of my life. It was amazing. I learned that there are certain irrational phenomena that occur in your life, in nature, and we have to wait for a while and learn to accept that as part of our lives.
There is a worthwhile immortality that we know so little when you consider the trillions of stars and galaxies. I mean, what the hell are we? We're nothing. And we have to must keep an open mind, because everything is possible, everything. Mm-hmm.